Hey everybody, what's going on? This is Sam from Historic Travels and welcome to another video. And as always, before we get started today, I'd just like to take a quick moment to welcome all my new subs and to thank everybody who's been leaving me comments and messages down below. Thank you all so much, I really appreciate it. And if you would like to take a couple of extra steps to help support the channel a little bit more, there's a merch store and a Patreon for this channel in the links below. Thank you all so much for all your support. Alright guys, well hey, the time has finally come to conclude the story of the RMS Carpathia and the role that it played on the night that the Titanic went down. And, alright guys, well hey, without any further ado, let's now conclude the story of the RMS Carpathia.
When we last left the RMS Carpathia, the ship was making all possible speed to the site at which the RMS Titanic was sinking. The Carpathia's wireless operator, Harold Cottam, had been listening to the Titanic's distress calls for the past several hours. Then, at 1:57 a.m., the Titanic went silent, and Harold Cottam had no idea why. Unfortunately, we all know why. Because at 1:57 a.m., the Titanic lost its ability to send wireless transmissions. And then, at 2:20 a.m., the RMS Titanic, the world's biggest and most luxurious vessel ever built, just sank into the middle of the North Atlantic, casting 1,496 people that were still on board the ship into the freezing cold North Atlantic Sea.
At the exact same time that the Titanic went down, the Carpathia was still a fairly good distance away from the Titanic. Now, as the Carpathia continued to steam towards the Titanic's location, the Carpathia entered the Titanic's ice field, the ice field at which it sunk in, at roughly 2:40 a.m. Now, remember, at this current time, the Carpathia is still steaming towards the wrong location in search of the Titanic. This is because the Titanic was broadcasting the wrong distress coordinates throughout the sinking. Now, as the Carpathia continued to steam into this ice field, Captain Rostrum was on the Carpathia's bridge looking ahead, trying to keep a sharp eye out for icebergs or other hazards that might be in front of the Carpathia. And then, Captain Rostrum noticed something interesting off the Carpathia's port side. He saw what appeared to be a green light hovering pretty high off of the horizon, which means that this green light was hovering above where the horizon line was. He didn't know what this was, but when Captain Rostrum saw this, he thought it was the Titanic. So he began to change course and head towards this green light, hoping that the Titanic was still afloat. Now, when Captain Rostrum saw this green light on the horizon, and the reason he thought this green light was the Titanic was, when he saw this light, he thought he was looking at one of the Titanic's navigation lights. Now, these may have been called running lights in 1912. If I'm wrong about that, please correct me in the comments below. However, for the sake of this video, I'm just gonna keep referring to them as navigation lights. So, for those of you who don't know, a navigation light is basically a light that is put on a ship to help another ship see your ship if it's observing it from afar. And then, the color of these lights change depending on which side of a ship you are looking at. Now, in the case of Titanic, the Titanic's navigation lights were located on the Titanic's bridge wing. There was a green light on the Titanic's starboard side bridge wing, and there was a red light on the Titanic's port side bridge wing. So that means that if you're on another ship and you see a green light and you're observing the Titanic, that means you're observing the Titanic from the ship's starboard side. And if you see a red light while you're observing the Titanic, that means you're observing the Titanic from the ship's port side. So that means that when Captain Rostrum on the Carpathia saw this green light on the horizon, he thought he was observing the Titanic's green starboard side navigation light. So, when he saw this green light on the horizon, he immediately changed course and had the Carpathia steam towards this light with all possible speed.
But in reality, these green lights that the Carpathia was seeing were actually flares being lit up by Titanic's fourth officer, Boxhall. You see, fourth officer Boxhall was in lifeboat number 2, and he was periodically lighting these green flares as a way to try to keep all of the lifeboats together and organized while these lifeboats waited for rescue. So, because Boxhall was lighting up these green flares, it allowed the Carpathia to see the green light from the flares, which allowed the Carpathia to know in which general direction to steam in order to locate the Titanic survivors.
Boy, I tell you, it really is a good thing that Boxhall had those flares with him and that he was periodically lighting these flares in order to try to organize the Titanic's lifeboats, because if he hadn't had this, the Carpathia would have continued to steam on to the area at which it thought the Titanic was at, and it would have taken a lot longer for the Carpathia to locate the Titanic survivors. Now, there's one thing about this story with Boxhall, the green flares, and the Carpathia that has always bothered me. You see, at the time that the Carpathia noticed the green light from the flares, The Carpathia was around 18 to 20 miles away from the area at which the Titanic went down. Now, I don't know for certain how far light can travel across the ocean under normal conditions, but I found it hard to believe that the green light from a flare was able to reach the Carpathia at 20 miles away. However, I do have a theory that may have helped the Carpathia see the light from this green flare. In case you didn't know this, there was a weird optical illusion effect going on in the area at which the Titanic went down on the night of the sinking. And I believe that optical illusion may have helped the Carpathia locate the Titanic survivors. Now, I'm not going to go into any detail about that in this video. I already made an entire video covering that topic. But if you would like to learn more about that, I will include a link to that video in the description below.
Over the course of the next hour, the Carpathia quickly steamed towards the site at which this green light had been spotted from. But what you have to remember is, at this current time, the Carpathia is currently within the exact same ice field that the Titanic had just sunk in. And as they were steaming closer and closer towards the location that this green light had been spotted from, they began to see more and more icebergs and growlers all around the Carpathia. For those of you who don't know, a growler is basically a small iceberg. And what you also have to remember is, the Carpathia is steaming through this ice field, traveling somewhere between 17 to 17.5 knots. Captain Rostron later said that it was a constant battle to keep the Carpathia from hitting one of these icebergs, due to the speed at which the Carpathia was sailing through it. So, that means that, if the Carpathia had struck one of these bergs, traveling at the speed that it was, then it's very possible the Carpathia would have sunk as well, laying on the seafloor right beside the RMS Titanic.
However, thanks to the efforts of Captain Rostron and his crew, the Carpathia was able to successfully navigate around all of these icebergs and reach the site at which the RMS Titanic had went down. The Carpathia reached this location somewhere between 3:30 and 4 a.m., and as the Carpathia began to approach this area, the Carpathia began to shoot off flares to let everybody who had just survived the Titanic disaster and was currently waiting for rescue in one of the Titanic's lifeboats, that help had finally arrived.
The first lifeboat to reach the Carpathia from Titanic was lifeboat number 2. This lifeboat reached the Carpathia and was brought aboard at roughly 4:10 a.m. Then, as the sun slowly began to rise over the Atlantic, more and more of the Titanic's lifeboats began to make their way towards the Carpathia. The rescue effort took roughly 4.5 hours, and in that amount of time, 705 survivors were rescued from the Atlantic Ocean, having just survived the sinking of the Titanic. Once on board the Carpathia, the Titanic survivors were given blankets and coffee, and they were given the option to go below deck and rest in the Carpathia's main dining room. And while some of the Titanic survivors did do this, many of the other survivors chose to stay on the Carpathia's boat deck and look out across the Atlantic for their loved ones who were not yet on board the Carpathia.
However, there would be no other survivors found from the Titanic disaster. With the exception of those who were in the Titanic's lifeboats, there would be no people found alive in the waters surrounding the area while the rescue effort was underway. Now, while the Carpathia was busy picking up the Titanic survivors, Harold Cottam was busy on the Carpathia's wireless system, letting all the ships in the area know what had just happened with the Titanic. Before the Carpathia left the area, another ship, the SS Californian, arrived at the site that the Carpathia was at and wondered if it could do anything to help. For those of you who don't remember, the Californian was the ship that was close enough to help the Titanic. However, the radio on the Californian wasn't on while the ship was sinking, so it didn't know what was going on. But the Carpathia told the Californian that there was nothing it could do, and the Carpathia was getting ready to leave the area. Believe it or not, there's even a photo of the Californian taken from the deck of the Carpathia right before the ship left the area. Once the Carpathia weighed anchor and departed the area with all the Titanic survivors on board, the Californian remained in the area for a brief period looking for any other Titanic survivors. But unfortunately, the only thing the Californian found were dead bodies and wreckage. So after a brief search, the Californian left the area and resumed its course.
Once the Carpathia had all of the Titanic survivors on board, they began to try to decide what to do with all of the Titanic survivors. Should the Carpathia take all of these people back to New York City? Should they be transferred to another White Star Line ship? The RMS Olympic, the Titanic sister ship, was quickly approaching the area, and it offered to take aboard all of the Titanic survivors. However, J. Bruce Ismay, the head of the White Star Line, who had just been rescued and was now on board the Carpathia, made the decision to not let the Olympic take on the Titanic survivors. Having being the near-identical twin to the Titanic, Ismay was afraid that seeing the Olympic might cause some of the Titanic survivors to have a panic attack. So, in the end, it was ultimately decided that the Carpathia would turn around and take the Titanic survivors back to New York City.
Once the Carpathia left the site at which the Titanic went down, it took the Carpathia several days to reach New York City. The Carpathia arrived in New York on April 18, 1912, at which point in time the Titanic survivors disembarked the ship. However, even though these people did survive the sinking of the Titanic, their lives would be forever altered by those events that they experienced on April 15, 1912. Not one person who survived the sinking of the Titanic would be unaffected by those events. And they would have to carry the memory and horror of what they experienced on that night for the rest of their lives. Well, guys, now all of you know the story of the Carpathia and the role that it played in helping the Titanic on the night that the ship went down. Now, if any of you would like to know what happened next, like what happened to the Titanic survivors after they reached New York, what happened to Ismay and the story of the Titanic following the sinking, I did make an entire video about that called The Fallout of the Titanic Disaster. I will include a link to that video in the description below, so feel free to check that out. But anyway, guys, thank you all so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video and found it interesting. And thank you all for joining me in the tale of the Carpathia. Y'all are awesome. All right, everybody. Well, hey, you all stay safe out there, and I will see you in the next one. Have a good day, everybody. Thank you all so much for tuning in.
Special thanks to our captain-level Patreon supporters, Olivia Julius, Canadian, Greg Gallick, and Callum Whaley. Thank you all so much for all the support.